Wow, what happened? On July the 19th, 2024, it was a Friday, at 4 o'clock and 9 minutes UTC, CrowdStrike released a sensor configuration update for their Falcon software to all Windows systems. Okay, but who is CrowdStrike? Now, CrowdStrike is an American cybersecurity firm which was founded in 2011. Their market capitalization is roughly $83 billion. Falcon is their software product that organizations install on their computers to keep them safe from cyber attacks and also from malware. It is also called an endpoint detection and response system, so an EDR software. These EDR softwares, they monitor what is happening on the computer. They are for looking for suspicious activity, for example, for malware. And if they detect something, this software helps you to lock down this threat. So far, so good. But what was the impact of that software update? So systems that were running that CrowdStrike Falcon sensor on Windows 7 and 11 or above systems that downloaded that configuration file in the time frame between 4 o'clock and 9 minutes UTC and 5 o'clock and 27 minutes UTC, they immediately crashed. So there were roughly 8.5 million Microsoft Windows PCs affected worldwide. The affected sectors where these Microsoft Windows PCs were running were airlines, government, railroads, banks, hospitals, international broadcast, stock exchange, and so on and so on. In these companies, on Windows PCs, you would just see now this picture here. And when you would have a look at Down Detector, you would see this picture here. Many companies around the world had outages. And of course, also when you look at the stock exchange, as soon as the world found out that CrowdStrike was the source of that problem, their share value went down. Just a quick disclaimer, I have absolutely no clue what exactly CrowdStrike did wrong. Of course, on the internet, there are a lot of rumors around that. But we will not have a look at these rumors. We want to have a look at what you can do to prevent exactly that from happening in your company. So the first thing what you can do is plan your deployment and releases. And here it's very important in DevOps, we distinguish between deployment and release. A deployment is bringing the compiled code into production with the feature toggle off, and the release is switching on the feature toggle. While coding, code reviews and pair programming are very important tools to ensure the quality of what you are building. With pair programming, you are always programming in pairs, which means you always have a buddy at your side, a second brain, which also looks together with you on the code. And that's a very important thing to spot errors like potentially this null pointer exception that just happened potentially at CrowdStrike. So when you are done with your feature, and even if you have done pair programming, then when you are finished with it and you are going to create merge request, then a second person will look at your code and potentially also spot errors in that. The third point that I added here is especially when you are building C++ applications. With C++ application, you always have the threat of having null pointer exceptions. You need to do with C++ your own memory management. At CrowdStrike, the system was implemented in C++, and potentially this was a null pointer exception that caused that massive outage. And therefore, what you need to do is use tools to prevent null pointer exception, and that would be the case with smart pointers, the third solution there. Next, we are now finished with the feature, with the coding, and we committed into the source code repository, which means now the software will be built, and there we always have a continuous integration system, which means we are reintegrating the new code with the rest of the code. As part of the continuous integration, we always do static analysis checks. For example, here in C++, that would be with Cppcheck to exactly also spot errors in the code, detect null pointer exceptions again here. When we are done with the continuous integration, everything was okay, then we go to the test automation. There we execute the unit test and the integration test, and we again do some dynamic analysis, which, for example, in C++ would be executed by Valgrind. Again here, the code will be now executed, and then during the execution, we will spot again null pointer exception or other exception with the tool Valgrind. Now, after these steps, we have a deployable artifact which was reviewed by another person, which was statically analyzed, and which was also dynamically analyzed. So therefore, we are ready to deploy it onto a staging environment. In this staging environment, we now use these feature toggles to toggle on and off the features so that we can test this software in this staging environment. Here we also can use blue-green deployment. The blue-green deployment is we have two environments, two staging environments here. One is live and there we are doing the testing. The other one is not live, and on the not live system, we will deploy our new version, and then we just will switch over to the new version of this system, and then we can test on this new version of the system. And if something fails, we can immediately go back to the old version, which is still there and running. Of course, blue-green deployments are mostly used in production systems, but of course, you can also use that already in the staging system. And finally, also here at the deployment, we also implement rollback mechanism. Blue-green deployment would be such a rollback mechanism, but another one could be we just uninstall the software and roll back to the previous version of the software. You can see until now, we have not yet released this software. This would mean in the CrowdStrike scenario, we have already deployed it, but we not have released the software. I don't know if that would help in the case of CrowdStrike, but now with the release, what we would do is we would go into a canary release mode, which means that we are going to release it first to a small user group to test if everything is okay, because then the blast radius would be not that big. Usually these are beta users which want to have the first version of that software. And that is canary releasing, and I'm pretty sure that this principle would have helped massively in the outage of CrowdStrike. Other principle is the dark launch. The dark launch is that we don't release the feature. We keep the feature toggled off, but we are continuously deploying new version into the production system. And again, we are only enabling it at special occasions with special systems. Usually these are our test systems where we are going to look if everything is okay. This is a so-called dark launch because you are continuously launching new versions, but the normal user will not see anything of the new features yet. Of course, as you can see, dark launch is a sort of a variant of canary releases, and the same goes for A/B testing. A/B testing is you again define a certain user group, you give the new feature to that user group, and the which is then the A group, and the B group has not yet that new feature. Now you can also see why I said first that it is important to plan your deployment and release strategies, because these three things, what I talked about, these are release strategies, and you of course need to first plan for that so that you can execute it accordingly. Now, the next thing is to have proactive detection. You want to find bugs before your clients. And now in the case of CrowdStrike, it was first the clients found out that there is a problem and not CrowdStrike. And you never want to have that. And for that, you need the second one. You need to have an alerting based on proactive detection. And the last thing is you want to have a continuous monitoring. You want to observe all of the systems and gather feedback from the systems so that you enable that proactive detection and that you can react on these things. So when we now summarize the whole thing for that CrowdStrike incident, then in my opinion, it would have been very, very useful to have pair programming and code reviews in place. Of course, static analysis of the source code and potentially also dynamic analysis of the runtime. I would say that you should have unit tests and integration tests where your software gets deployed onto different Windows versions, checking if everything is okay, including reboot mechanisms. And with that, the last thing would be the canary releases. I would implement canary releases, which means that new versions are first going to a better user group that gets the newest features. And with that, you are massively are going to decrease the blast radius of such incidents. And with that, we are coming to the end of this video. And the important thing is we will not be able to prevent such incidents. We only can reduce the blast radius of such incidents. We see that we live now in a highly connected world, and that software runs that world. And for that, we need to learn from our failures, have a proper post-mortem on that, really analyze the root cause of these failures, improve based on that, apply the DevOps principles that I just show you. And for me, one of the very important thing is we as an industry, we need to build resilient systems. And here I also look at Microsoft. Why did Microsoft not have a more resilient Windows system? Why is it possible that such a software from CrowdSource can bring down the whole operating system? Which means what where we need to go as an industry is to build these resilient systems. And for that, we need to apply software engineering. And here I really want to point out, we need to engineer, properly engineer our systems. And with that, thank you very much for watching this video. If you like this video, please leave me a thumbs up and don't forget to subscribe to this channel because I will create every month a new video for you.